Good morning, everyone. I'm Mark Segraves. Welcome to NewsPlus. On today's show, we break down the race for governor in Maryland. We talked to one of the winners of the recent DC primary, and big-time celebrity Nick Cannon was in town, and that's right, we got him right here on NewsPlus. All that and more, and it's starting right now. Segraves. Well, the race for governor in Maryland is heating up. We had Bruce Depuyt, our friend from News Channel 8, the host of News Talk, to come in and break down the election for us. Bruce, we just got through going through what is just an epic upheaval in the DC government. There's going to be change in Maryland as well. We know there's going to be a new governor. There are three candidates running. Where are we right now in that race?
As you indicate, the incumbent governor, Martin O'Malley, is term limited. In fact, he's in the eighth year of his 8 years as governor of Maryland. You can already see him and feel him starting to pivot to what's next. It's widely known that
he's got his eyes on the White House, or at least something along those lines.
Unless we all are misjudging this, you're going to see Martin O'Malley in places like Iowa and New Hampshire sooner rather than later. And the race, as you indicate, to succeed him is on. You've got Republicans, multiple Republicans, jockeying for the Republican nomination. More focus right now is on the Democratic primary because Maryland is such a Democratic-leaning state. They only elect Republicans once in a blue moon to be governor. And you have a fairly hotly contested nomination fight on the Democratic side. You've got the sitting Lieutenant Governor Anthony Brown. You've got the sitting Attorney General Doug Gansler. And you've got a state delegate Heather Mazier. I say fairly hotly contested because these are all people with resumes and issues, accomplishments that they've worked on, ambition, all the rest. And even though the history works against Anthony Brown, because no lieutenant governor in Maryland going back to the 1800s has ever become governor, the polls suggest this race is his to lose right now. Doug Gansler and Heather Mazier have got to figure out a way to alter the dynamic, or Brown, it appears, is going to cruise to the nomination and probably to victory.
And where many people, particularly the Gansler campaign, see Brown's Achilles heel is the healthcare rollout in the state of Maryland.
No question. This was an epic failure. This was an issue where everyone said, here's Anthony Brown's, one of the prime pieces of his portfolio. You know, lieutenant governors only do what the governor gives them to do. And in this case, he was involved. He is said to have been deeply involved in the creation of a web portal. Maryland is being one of those states that didn't say, we'll use the federal site, we'll develop our own, which was an option many states had and which many states took. But you look at states like Kentucky and Connecticut, which did a fantastic job. Well, Maryland, not so much. In fact, Maryland's is kind of the poster child for how not to do it. And there's some question as to how much of this will be an embarrassment and a liability for the lieutenant governor as he campaigns. It's certainly an issue that his primary rivals and whoever emerges as the Republican nominee is going to hit him with and hit him hard, because it's going to be hard to put enough lipstick on this pig for it to look like anything but a pig.
And what has Brown been saying as his defense?
That that his job was to get it through the legislature, that he was a champion of the program in broad terms, but he's not an IT guy, he's not a nuts and bolts computer software guy, and so he wasn't down there in the code mucking around and making sure this thing got set up right. And probably no one expects a top politician to be in the code working to establish a website. There is the sense that if you've got these primary responsibilities, you've got to be keeping the people who report to you and the, by extension, the people who report to them focused and where they need to be for deadlines to be met and all the rest of it. So he can probably escape some criticism because, again, the expectation is politicians aren't computer experts in that sense, but it is on them to make sure that deadlines are met and that things happen as they should. And that was not the case here. It's costing a bundle for them to fit this and to fix this. It's been a huge problem and it's a huge embarrassment.
So, you know, we saw Gansler stumble a little out of the blocks. He had some issues with his son going to a party and him attending this beach beer blast down in Rehoboth Beach, and there was videotape, which is, you know, the worst sin in the world is to do something wrong and have it videotaped. And that plagued Gansler, and he doesn't seem to have really caught fire, I think, like Gansler thought he was going to.
It seems like it has stymied him, even though the headlines are several weeks and months old now. There was the other story too about did he tell his troopers, "Hey,
the speeding, right?
Yeah, yeah, I'm late for my appointment. Hit the gas and go through that red light or speed, whatever. Use the sirens." It diminished him. It hurt him, and he's struggling now, even now, to gain traction. Even though he's had tremendous success as an elected official. He was a couple or three terms as Montgomery County State's attorney, did very well there, running sort of as an outsider against the establishment candidate, running twice successfully for attorney general. And as you know, candidates from Montgomery County rarely venture out onto the statewide stage, much less are they successful. Gansler has defied the odds there. But he's run into a bit of a brick wall, and the controversies have not helped at all. He needs to alter the trajectory of this race for it to be considered a really close race, at least given the polls that we're seeing at this point.
So is there time for Gansler to turn things around? I mean, we're discounting Heather Missouri, and I apologize to her for being so dismissive of her campaign, but it really seems that it's down to these two guys for the Democratic nomination.
And I think that's the perception almost everyone has. Heather Missouri is a state delegate from one piece of Montgomery County. She's just not that well known. Doug Gansler is the attorney general for the state of Maryland. People in Maryland, in both parties, have pulled the lever for him many, many times. There is time. I think he's waiting on debates. I think debates could be a good moment for him, but the polls show him just not as competitive as you indicate, as he would like to be at this point.
Bruce Depuyt is the host of News Talk on News Channel 8. You can catch that every Monday through Friday at 10 o'clock on News Channel 8 and watch it online. And we always appreciate when you come in here and kind of make sense of all this political landscape.
I do my best. Thanks for the invite.
All right. More of News Plus right after this. Welcome back to News Plus, everyone. I'm Mark Segraves, and now I sit down with Brianne Nadeau. She won the Democratic primary for the Ward 1 council seat, defeating longtime incumbent Jim Graham. We had a chance to talk to her about her race for the general election and what she'll do if and when she's elected. You know, I think a lot of people are tuning into this, a little surprised that you beat a longtime incumbent by Jim Graham, who by all accounts was a pretty savvy politician and no stranger to opposition. But I think also a lot of people are probably just meeting you for the very first time. I know you're not originally from D.C., and you were a Girl Scout. It looks like you're probably going to be on the D.C. Council. Can you fill in some gaps for us there?
Sure, I'd be happy to. So you know about the early years.
Yes.
I moved to D.C. 12 years ago, right after college. So I was in Michigan, I went to Boston College, and then I came here right away to do work in the nonprofit world. So I was in the nonprofit world for 4 years working with student activists. And then I went on to work for Congressman John Sarbanes on his first campaign in 2006. We won that, went to Congress, and I was there with him for 5.5 years before moving on to a very small PR firm in Woodley Park, Rabinowitz Communications, and now I manage that firm. And I also serve on the board of directors of Jews United for Justice, which is an organization that's focused on economic justice, issues like increasing the minimum wage, paid sick leave for restaurant workers, and making our tax code more fair and more progressive.
And you live in Ward 1, obviously.
Yes,
have you
indeed.
Always, has that always been your, since you've lived here in D.C.?
I've been in Ward 1 for 10.5 years now, right in Meridian Hill, where I live and where I served as an ANC as well.
And so you come to town, you decide you're gonna take on Jim Graham. Why did you decide that this was gonna be your calling?
Well, D.C. is my home now, and I really have built a life here over the past 12 years. So it would be, I don't think we want to depict it as me coming here to challenge Jim Graham by any means, but I got involved in the work of the community. Back in 2005, I first started on the Orange Hat Patrol, our neighborhood watch, and that was a great opportunity to get to know my neighbors better. Every week, walking the beat with the police and other neighbors and talking about the issues that were happening on the street. And from there, went on to get more engaged with the Meridian Hill Neighborhood Association and eventually run for ANC. And the issues that I was hearing from people during that time were serious ones. Not only the day-to-day of filling potholes and fixing street lamps, but also as a young family, how do you build a life here? How do you afford a home? How do you trust the schools? As a longtime resident, you're feeling the squeeze. You're feeling everything change around you. And how can we help you stay in the community that you love, that you lived in, you raised your kids in, you know, and everybody in between?
And so you win the Democratic primary. There was nobody running in the Republican primary,
right,
for the Ward 1 seat. So in order for you to face any opposition, someone would had to pop up for the general election to run as most likely an independent.
Sure.
That most likely scenario would be Brian Weaver, someone who has been on this show before, who has run for office before, certainly is active in your community, but he's kind of on the fence. I guess he hasn't really committed yet to,
sure,
to exactly what he's going to do. I can't remember a Democrat losing in the general election in the District of Columbia, so it looks like, barring some catastrophic upset meltdown on your part or something happening that is completely unforeseen, that you'll be the next D.C. council member from Ward 1 after the November primary come January 1st. This is a long time. This is the first time we moved the primary up to April. What will you do in this time between now and the general, let's say if you end up not having any opposition?
Mm-hmm. Well, we take nothing for granted. Of course, we won't know until July whether or not we have a challenger from an independent challenger. And so in the meantime, I'm doing exactly what I would do either way, which is continue to be out there talking to voters, talking to members of the community, spending time in events, and really continuing to move around the ward. I made it a point in this campaign, in the primary, to really touch every corner of the ward. I went door to door for a year, talking to people one-on-one and hearing about the issues they cared about. And I'll continue to be out there talking to people one-on-one. Now it's a little bit more casual. I was at the trolley turnaround park yesterday with some friends, bumped into some other residents who wanted to chat for a few minutes. And so it's more of that, as these informal conversations. And so the more I go out there, the more opportunities I
have. Are you still raising money?
Yes, absolutely.
And so let's flash forward then to next January and assume, for the sake of conversation, that you do win, that you do get sworn in as the next D.C. council member for one. It's going to be a different D.C. council. We know there's going to be a new mayor.
Mm-hmm.
We know that. There's definitely going to be a new Ward 1 council member. There's going to be a new Ward 6 council member, because Tommy Wells gave up his seat. That will likely be Charles Allen, who won the Democratic primaries, in the same situation that you are. If Muriel Bowser wins in the general, there will have to be a special election for her Ward 4 seat. And if David Catania stays in the race for mayor, he will have given up his seat. So there could be four new council members. This comes after we just got McDuffie and Grosso, Bonds. We've got some new council members, kind of trending younger. So what do you see as your agenda? What do you see as your platform? When you get on the council, what committee would you like to be on? What legislation would you like to push forward?
So the things that we talked about a lot in the campaign were no accident, because having been out talking to voters every day, every weekend, going door to door, I really had a sense of what it was they cared about. And my goal is to take their voices with me to the Wilson Building. So we'll focus on things like strengthening our schools, increasing affordable housing, and really rooting out corruption in the government. And I think that with this new slate, we're going to have an opportunity to really get good government as a priority, and that allows us to then do the work on the issues.
Let me ask you about schools, and I'm a DCPS stakeholder with the high school and middle school, and I got to tell you what a lot of parents are talking about is the new plan for boundaries,
mm-hmm,
to change the boundary system. There are a couple proposals on the table. It's not really clear whether this will get done and implemented before a new mayor comes in and maybe make some changes, but I'm sure you've looked at these proposals from Kaya Henderson.
Yeah.
Where do you fall on these?
Well, the thing we were hearing from parents through these community discussions was one of the number one things that they need is stability, right? So I'm concerned that we get through this process and make sure that that's what parents are getting. They want stability, they want strong neighborhood schools, and they want equity across the system.
But should a parent be able to know that I live in this neighborhood likely because I moved there because of the schools in many cases, that I'll be able to go to the schools in my neighborhood, that I won't be thrown into some citywide lottery system that the DCPS is calling choice, but is really more chance than choice.
Right.
Are you in favor of that, or are you more along the lines of protecting the people who want to go to school in their neighborhoods?
My focus has always been on the neighborhood schools, protecting those schools, protecting the matter of right trajectory for a child. And what I want to do is ensure that every feeder pattern we have across the district is a strong one. I grew up in a place where I could walk to a safe, strong school, and I want every kid to have that chance, that opportunity. Right now, the strength of a child's education is dependent on where they live or how lucky they are in a lottery. And we need to ensure that no matter where you live, no matter what your luck is, that you have a strong school to go to.
Let me ask you about taxes. There will probably be, there will definitely be talk of changing the tax structure.
Yes.
There have been proposals from former Mayor Williams' task force about tweaking the sales tax. Muriel Bowser has already said that if she becomes mayor, she would be in favor of raising the sales tax in order to provide a middle class income tax cut. Where do you fall on taxes, on income taxes, sales taxes, any changes there?
Well, the work that I've done with Jews United for Justice is really to create a more progressive tax system, which would mean that the burden falls more heavily on those who are doing the best. Right, and we would be lifting the burden from our most vulnerable populations. So that's always been my focus when I went and testified before Mayor Williams' commission, was really how do we change those brackets and the percentages and the marginal rates so that the burden is not falling on the lowest income folks. I think, raising taxes is never going to be something that I'm drawn to, because I think what we need to be doing is being more efficient with the tax dollars we have and making sure we're using every dollar wisely.
Brianne Nadeau is the Democratic nominee for Ward 1 Council coming up in the general election. Brianne, thanks for joining us.
Thank you.
More News Plus right after this. Welcome back to News Plus. I'm Mark Segraves, and now our correspondent Robin Hamilton had a chance to catch up with Nick Cannon. He was in town recently for the walk to end lupus.
Lupus is a mysterious disease. It's an autoimmune disease that can ravage certain parts of the body. There is no known cure. It can be fatal, but many people are learning to live with it. Today, we're here at the Lupus Foundation for America walk, and we had a chance to speak to a celebrity who is dealing with the disease and living with it, Nick Cannon.
How's everybody doing? Thank you so much. I'm excited to be here. It's amazing to see so many people here. Give yourselves a round of applause for coming out to support. Feel like I'm representing from my fellow loopies. We out here, we making it happen. And that's the beauty of...
Well, tell me about your journey, about when you first realized you had lupus to where you are today.
I was diagnosed with lupus nephritis in 2012. And it was, it was a trying time, in and out of the hospital, figuring it all out. But since then, it's been nothing but a grind forward, and to be in great shape now. I always say the best shape of my life. To now use my test as a testimony is the goal, is the mission, and it's one of the reasons why we're here today. Now health has to be a lifestyle more than just an idea or a thought. So it's the thing that I kind of think about first when I wake up. So everything from prayer to meditation to the proper diet to staying hydrated and ultimately getting a proper amount of rest. It's outstanding to be a part of this event today. I mean, when you're a part of any community, but a community of people that are fighting for a cure for a disease and a condition is outstanding. And to be out here with, as I say, my fellow loopies, it's pretty cool.
Thanks for that report, Robin. Now, staying in that whole entertainment vein, our entertainment critic Willie Waffle is here with his weekly movie review, and this week, Willie takes a look at Spider-Man 2.
The temperature is rising. Ladies are wearing those pretty frilly little sundresses everywhere I go, and grown men are on the big screen wearing spandex. Yep, the summer movie season is here, and it kicks off this week with The Amazing Spider-Man 2. Andrew Garfield is back as Peter Parker, and man, is his life getting complicated. He's still in love with Gwen Stacy, even though he promised her dad he would stay away from Gwen to keep her out of danger. An obsessed fan played by Jamie Foxx has suffered an accident at Oscorp, and now he has morphed into the villain Electro and wants revenge on everyone who ignored him and took advantage of him throughout his life. Oh, and Peter's pal Harry Osborn has returned to town, and he needs Spider-Man's blood to overcome a crippling disease that is killing Daddy Osborn and has been passed down to him too. You think that might cause a little rift between those BFFs? Summer movies usually mean bigger and louder, but The Amazing Spider-Man 2 needs to economize a little bit. Andrew Garfield is great as Peter Parker, as we see the young man grappling with all sorts of emotions, responsibilities, and so much confusion as he tries to sort out the right path for himself as he attempts to come to grips with his past, present, and future. Frankly, it's almost a shame to see Garfield all covered up with the mask and spandex, since he is so good at playing Parker versus spouting some one-liners as Spider-Man. However, I just wish we had one villain to focus on, because both of these guys deserve more time to grow the characters and make them into more than cartoons. Jamie Foxx is fantastic as Electro, but we never get enough time to see his previous life and understand all the reasons he is full of rage and bitterness. Before the big event that makes him the bad guy, Foxx could have given the character more of a sympathetic vibe, which would have caused some great mixed emotions with the audience. Then Dane DeHaan elevates Harry Osborn beyond being a sniveling little spoiled brat, even when the script doesn't quite reach the same heights his performance does. The Amazing Spider-Man 2 has all the action you want, especially those mind-blowing scenes of the webbed ones swinging through the city with abandon. So how about we give it 2.5 waffles? And check out more of my reviews at DC50TV.com. You know you want to.
Well, that's News Plus for another week, folks. Hey, if you want to stay current on all the news that's breaking on our area, you should be following me on Twitter. As we leave you today, some scenes from Healthy DC.
Hi, I'm Laurent. I'm with pro boxer Mike Yes Indeed Reed. He's going to tell us how to be fast. Mike, what's your favorite speed exercise?
This is actually my favorite. I hit the mitts with my dad. We burn out for 3 minutes. Get me real fast.
Show me some speed.
That's fast.
I'm Laurent, and I'll see you soon.